Macmillan Audio presents The Salt Grows Heavy, written by Cassandra Khaw, narrated by Susan Dalian. One. The first night.
Where are you going?
I pause. In the penumbra, the fading dusk, gorgeted by coral and gold, you could be forgiven for mistaking the ruined house, a ribcage. The roof, its tent of ragged skin. The foundation, at a careless look, could pass for bones. The door for a mouth. The chimney, a finger crooked at the sky. Or at a wife who would not be a savior. Ash sleets from the firmament in soft handfuls of black, gathering in gauzy drifts around my ankles. The sky is ink and seething murk, whispering secrets to itself, the clouds snarled like long, dark hair. I glance into the house. Two of my daughters look back, eyes shining. They are seated astride a twitching form, its limbs too small to have belonged to an adult. Like cats, they croon to one another, even as they nibble their fins and fingertips clean. My breath snags. Only days old, but already they are the best of their parents. They have their father's full lips, his blue eyes, his supple, sun-warmed skin. And they have my teeth. My deep water hair, like the lures of the anglerfish spun into thick coils. Nothing sticks to those radiant strands, no amount of gore or mud, which is fortunate given how messily my offspring eat. One fishes a gnawed down finger bone from her maw, flicks it to the ground. The other pounces, and for a moment, I glimpse the fair circle of their victim's face. Its eyes gouged, its cheeks flinched, its skull emptied of sweetbreads. Mermaids, especially those born half-prince, leave nothing to waste.
Of course, I forgot. You can't speak. My apologies.
I look back. The plague doctor flutters a hand, voice strange behind their mask. Today they are dressed most austerely. Plain black robes, a broad-brimmed hat, the half-skull of a vulture, carefully bleached, unornamented, save for a single hieroglyph embossing its brow. Alone of my husband's people, what few remain after the apocalypse of my children's hunger, the plague doctor is not afraid, has not ever been afraid.
Do you know where you're going?
I consider the question. I'd toyed with the idea of going home. In my dreams, I still swim that soundless black, still travel its eddies of salt and cold nothing. My sisters are alive in these nocturnal fantasies, colorless, resplendent, their hair floating like a frothing of wedding veils. But those are just baseless images pieced together by the unconscious, invoked by a longing that has since had time to turn septic. I have been on dry land for too long. The depths would devour me the way they would any creature of the air.
Well?
The plague doctor steps closer, fearless, eyes green as the humid, hated summer. I shrug. To my astonishment, they laugh.
Such a pair we make. I don't know what I'm going to do either, what with the kingdom being eaten to nothing.
The look they slide me, heavy-lidded and coquettish, is so audacious that I soundlessly laugh in spite of myself.
If you don't know where you're going, do you at least know what you plan to do?
I shrug again. Over the snow-gilded mountains, I know there are kingdoms without number, pastoral and beautiful,
each ruled by another prince or king, another czar and his court of calm-eyed lackeys, another man like my husband. Beautiful and terrible and cocksure in the magic he'd thieved from his bride. There. I could go there, perhaps. Find another sovereign who'd fish a mute from the waters, who'd marry her, bed her, murder her sisters for a superstition, and then pry the teeth from her gums for the sake of caution. I could find one of those again, maybe, and wait until my daughters come to gnaw his country down to its bones. As though conscious of my musings, the plague doctor nods, their voice hollowed by the fluted bone. Even after all this time, I cannot tell whether they are male, female, neither, both, some gradient wicking between definitions. And you shall know her by the trail of dead. A harpy phrase. I smile at the music of it. How do you feel about company? I cock my head. A doctor is always useful, they tell me, fox sly. What do you say? I say nothing, of course. My husband cut the tongue from me when he discovered I was pregnant, braised it with five spice and saffron before feeding me the tender slivers. Animal meat was forbidden, but assisted autosarcophagy, his soothsayer had croned, would ensure pliance. But I smile nonetheless, and it is answer enough for my new companion. We burned the kingdom to cinders. Pillars of choking smoke rose from the bodies we'd heaped into neat stacks, stinking fattily, saltily of crisping pork. The plague doctor had insisted. To leave the bodies as they were was to invite disease, an epidemic that would rot the soil, infect the waters. What is the point of revenge if you can't enjoy it? The plague doctor chuckled as they led me and my chocolate-stippled horse, my husband's last gift before our children made a feast of him, a sullen gelding who loathed him as much as I did, from the smoldering ruins. I offered no reply and instead watched the smoke, like warnings of what would be. In winter, as in spring, the taiga is beautiful. Pine trees and white spruce scrape at the firmament, skeining the snow in strange patterns. There are smaller plants, too, aspen and alder and birch, even colonies of withered ferns. Occasionally, I catch sight of wolves in the tree line, shark, sleek and gray, of bobcats glaring yellow-eyed from some desecrated barrow, of foxes, their muzzles sodden and dripping with red. The plague doctor's breath plumes through the air as we walk. Mine does not. Though I hold no particular affection for it, the cold has never been a thing I fear, a fact that once amused my husband's court to no end. They made me promenade through the winter, my naked skin iridescing with frost. Still, my companion insists on swaddling me in fur, woolly gloves, and a bearskin coat of unusual pallor. It would look strange if you weren't dressed for the weather, the plague doctor says in way of explanation, as I fondle my gifts, the lining smelling of musk and frankincense oil. The fur itself is almost satiny, a delight to massage between my fingers. People would ask questions. I scan the wilderness. There is no one but the hares and the badgers here, nothing but the trees and the quiet, the hawks and the whites, the unsleeping dead burning forever, unable to rest, pacing spindle-limbed through the gloom. If there are men concealed in the boughs, they harbor no interest in our acquaintance. For fear of my plague doctor, perhaps. Or me. The plague doctor laughs, arsenic sharp, a bark of a noise before crunching into a bright red apple. A stranger is an easy target. Easier still when they are as strange as you. If you had believed our former kingdom cruel, a place of treachery, let me assure you that it was the finest of its neighbors. The rest of them. Something of a smile emerges, a private amusement. anyway. Yes, the furs should help, at least until you smile. Your teeth will give us away immediately, the plague doctor murmurs as they chew, their voice softer, kinder. I'm surprised that your tongue didn't grow back with them.
I shrug. The physiology of my species is protean, unmetered by logic. When we breed with angels, our children accrete feathers. When we lay with hurricanes, we birth storms, wind spirits with the voices of dead sailors. 1,000 mythologies contributed to my conception. Who can say which of them was responsible for this miracle? I stroke the stump of my tongue. Enough has regrown so that I might separate bitterness from salt, might savor the taste of muscle briefly seared, over my back teeth, tracing the needle-thin growths, and shrug again, more empathically than before. In answer, the plague doctor guffaws, a vulpine sound this time. There is no more conversation after that. We stop, once or thrice, to attend to the little shrines that dot the woods, half buried in the snow. Wax clogs their hearts like colored tendons, the corpses of 1,000 candles. Food rots without, untouched by the forest.
I don't believe in souls, the plague doctor whispers at one point, voice husked, and I suspect the words are intended for someone else. Some time else, a place and a moment as distant from the present as I am from the sea. They extract a feather, black as pitch, save for its meridian of fire, from a satchel and place it atop the melted tallow. But just in case, a feather to help them fly home.
Theirs is the only feather amidst the despoiled charcuterie, the mold-spotted breads. I do not ask why or what, or how the plague doctor expects the spirit to ascend on a single plume of ebony. Even if I had the voice to do so, I would not have. This is not my grief to split from throat to belly, not my past to reconstruct from viscera and ice. And besides, who am I to speak on this? All of my kind are just souls with a cloak of skin and scales, barely tethered to the act of living. We walk until the moon reaches its zenith, a cataract eye glowering from the star-drowned sky. Then, at a clearing, a square of land jagged with old cairns and vacated graves, its denizens either cannibalized by the forest or changed by it, my travel mate declares, "We'll stop here." I dismount with the plague doctor's assistance, out of courtesy rather than any actual need. Parturition has not weakened me. If anything, it has done the reverse. But these small courtesies seem to please my companion, so I perform these rites as a small concession, a trade for services rendered. In the distance, something moans, low and displeased. A wolf, maybe, or a daughter of mine, sharp-teethed and jeweled with onyx scales, already grown bored of her butchered kingdom. The stars blink out, one after another, eaten by the rising fog. Still, whatever it might be, the plague doctor evidences no interest in its existence, divvying up our responsibilities with a non-committal authority. I am placed in charge of the fire of this evening's meal. The plague doctor tasks himself with everything else: defenses, the replenishment of our rations, the ablutions of my mount. Mine are easier duties than I'd anticipated, despite my inexperience with the world, my husband having kept me cloistered, a bloody jewel swaddled in the dark. I have an unerring sense of which branches serve better as kindling and which are still green and wet at their heart. The fire comes quickly too, a flash of orange gold lunging for me like a lover thrice denied. For food, I roast us the trout that the plague doctor supplies. The meat is clumsily seasoned. Some dried thyme, some basil crushed under a jag of rock, a rich spill of peppercorns, before it is then cooked with too much eagerness, too little skill,
and not enough sense. It's edible. I wouldn't worry too much, remarks the plague doctor, later as they pick chunks of black burnt meat from their share, first examining the charred meat by the darting flame light before tossing it into the snow. Once they have whittled the ash away, they eat. I devour mine whole, ash and bones and all. When we finish eating, we lapse into silence, one watching the other. The fog deepens, and the firelight smears orange across the plague doctor's mask.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.